You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And since last time I had this guest on, I have molded into my role as a father, as he has become the daddy of European and Asian wrestling. I had such a good idea for this intro, and I've just absolutely fluffed it. But on this edition, returning first time since October 2022, it's the blood tourist, Lou King Sharp. Welcome back.
Thank you very much for having me on, mate. And don't worry, I enjoyed the intro.
It's fine, I had it in my head. It's like, I looked at the date and I thought it was going to be like, since we last chatted, I've become a dad. And I looked at the date and went, no, I was a dad at that point. Shit. All plans go off the table. Anyway, but yeah, it's good to have you back on. Like we were saying off recording, can't believe it's been a year and a half since we've had you on. I think it's because I've seen you that often now. I've seen you at WrestleZone at the start of the year, and I've seen you at W3L and that. It just feels like I've had you on more recently than that. But here we go. So yeah, lots to fit in and catch up on in the last 2 years, and
100%.
A lot has happened in the world of Lou King Sharp in that last 2 years, as well as what's coming up as well. So we're going to try and fit all that in this next, I don't know, hour or so, as I like to do. So yeah, I've come here, if I've already asked. All well, all good in the land of Lou King Sharp.
I cannot complain. The shows have been going well. I've been busier than ever. I'd say it's gone well in Lou King Sharp land.
So last time we spoke, it was Dane Spotting. It was for Dane Spotting. We were doing the wee preview for it. So that was one of your first under your tenure. And you're in officially in your tenure as CCW, which is now Valor. So yeah. It seems to be just going from strength to strength. What was the decision to just officially just go from Copenhagen Championship Wrestling to Valor?
So I guess it kind of starts with Dane Spotting. Obviously, we were still Copenhagen Championship Wrestling back then. That was our first ever Scottish show. And really, we always had the kind of idea to expand across Europe. And it got to a point where we were doing more shows in Scotland than we were in Denmark. So the name wasn't really making much sense. So it's been Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. And then we also joined up with a team from Malmo, and we're going to start, doing events there as well. So we thought the time was right going into the new year to just start everything fresh under the new banner. Do that with all the kind of European events going forward.
So why Valor? Why Valor is the name itself?
If you look up the definition of the word itself, it's bravery, essentially. You know what I mean? It's showing bravery in the face of adversity. And really, it's a big project. It's took a lot of bravery to take it on. It's one thing just starting a regular independent wrestling promotion, but it's a whole different game trying to run shows across three separate countries with, three different languages. It's a big task, and no one's ever really done, at an independent level, no one's ever really done anything of the sort. So it took a lot of valor, I guess, to go for it. But we had a big vote on name, everybody that was involved, and that's the one we came out with.
But you're right, because you're trying to, if you're trying to put some sort of, I remember Dane Spotting was going to be on Danish TV and things like that. So you're trying to get a through line of stories across four countries, and like you say, four languages, and making sure that every country still got the payoff at the same time. And it's, that sounds like my brain's hurting just considering that. I'm not dealing with any of the actual real life stuff about it. I'm just thinking about the concept of trying to get all those puzzle pieces together.
I mean, yeah, like you need to make sure every crowd knows they're just as important as the other ones. You know what I mean? We can't put too much of a focus on anywhere. We want each crowd to get the full kind of Valor experience. And I think we've done pretty well with that. In the sense that every show is totally international. It's not like you're going to go to a Scottish show and only see the Scottish guys. You're going to see the guys from Scandinavia. You're going to see the guys from Poland and from, you know, Czech Republic and places like that, America. Every show you go to is going to be a genuinely international card. And you're going to see a lot of the same faces and same characters and same storylines, whether you're in Malmo or if you're in Kirkintilloch.
But I think Valor's the only place where you can actually say that as a sentence, that you'll see the same things in Malmo and in Kirkintilloch. So between all of that, you're still active yourself as looking sharp as the wrestler. So when I haven't got my timelines in front of me here, but with all that Valor stuff happening, around about that time, I think you said you were stepping away from ICW. Was that kind of the decision you had to put more focus on all the other things that you're doing, and ICW had to kind of take a back seat to it?
Yeah, so the decision was to go with Valor and doing my own thing in Glasgow. So I had to kind of step out of the kind of ICW bubble for that. And again, it goes back to the kind of sacrifices that we all made to make it possible. But 100% believe that it was the right decision. I think we're gonna, you know, do something genuinely different. And I think we're gonna do something that has a lot of potential to really revive British wrestling and Glaswegian wrestling in particular. There was a time where there was 9,000 wrestling fans paying to see independent wrestling in Glasgow. Like, these people haven't disappeared. They just need the right show, and I think Valor's it.
And it's, you're right. And it's this just seems to be a topic that's coming up quite a lot recently in my chats. Had it with Greg Lambert, who did the books, and other people recently, that since wrestling came back, people are still a little bit unsure about getting back out and going to the wrestling again for what variety of reasons, financial or whatever. It's still just finding that place to just light that fire again and get to that level again. Because as we're speaking, and as before this goes out, we've got Clash at the Castle. That'll be the weekend this goes out. And it's just, what, 11,000 people, 11,000 tickets have been sold as of recording. So there is still the market there. It's just getting them.
Yeah, there's absolutely enough people out there, and I think it's just going to take the right combination of, you know, what made things special before, and also, you know, something entirely different as well. We're kind of blending it in. It's a new take on what we all loved before. Brought to you by the same people that, you know, made it happen last time, and I think we can all do it again.
And as someone who, yourself, you seem to have quite a lot of history in wrestling in general, and you seem to know who to pick up, where to go, and all that kind of stuff. Have you been kind of studying all how promotions were before, how ICW was before, or how these places that sold thousands of tickets?
Yeah,
were?
Absolutely. It's not just ICW. I mean, like, there was a time where there was ICW and Preston and Progress, and, you know, and that's no disrespect to these promotions now, they're all still doing great, but, you know, Progress was in Wembley, and, you know, Preston was one of the hottest promotions in the world. You know, some of the biggest stars in the world coming in for it as well. And I think I've had a look at what people loved about British wrestling at that time, and I feel like we're working that into Valor now, and hopefully we can be looked at eventually in the same regard as those kind of places that I've mentioned.
Yeah, I mean, I think the companies that are big now, in my opinion anyway, would be like your North and your Soft Pro, especially over the border, and it's all about big characters, and that's something that Valor certainly has in spades.
Yeah, 100%.
plenty of big characters like God's Country and all the international guys you bring in from Scandinavia, your Sebastian Days, your Nitro Greens and the like. So yeah, it's fascinating to see it grow. And just to throw this question out here, did you shoot Jimmy the Ref?
I did not. Okay. But we will get to the bottom of that. Detective Charlie Anderson has took up the case.
Oh, Charlie Anderson. He was the first guest on this season, and he was an absolute delight to have on.
Charlie's very, very entertaining.
It's the only time, this will be 280th episode of the podcast, and it's the first time we had a banjo being played. And thanks to Charlie Anderson. So...
And Charlie, the reason he got the banjo is because we said in Denmark when he was making his Swedish debut that we were going to start a banjo band. I've been lacking. I've yet to even buy a banjo, but Charlie's already playing it clearly.
Well, you grew the mullet. You know, you're still like
I'm working on it in other aspects, but yeah, I'll get the banjo eventually.
You'll get the what's it, the old washboard, the wee scratch washboard, and you could do that instead. But no, absolutely, it's seeing stuff like the wee promos. I've mentioned it a couple of times this season, but the Charlie Anderson one where he sings Simply the Best, just it killed me as soon as I watched it. It was just one of the just so left field funniest bits that I've seen, was him singing Simply the Best and a boy standing up. Was it one of KOE, I think it was, and a Celtic top going to batter him. It's just but he said, if I remember rightly, that him going to the dojo kind of unleashed that bit of creative side. He was a little bit more free and loose to do that sort of thing. Is that something that, for the dojo, and I'm just going straight from Valor to the dojo, but is that something you kind of promote yourself for, providing a space to kind of let people be creative and find new ways to do things?
Yeah, absolutely. Like, I think most people who come to the dojo have been on shows for a long time. And I think in some aspect they kind of feel like they need a change and they need to start doing something different. I think the dojo is able to offer them that. There's a lot of kind of experienced people involved as well as myself, that are able to kind of take a look at them in a new light, I guess, and kind of add in things that maybe they wouldn't have thought of, or you know, pick up on things that they can take advantage of that they wouldn't necessarily have realised before. I think a lot of people are really coming out of their shell. Charlie Anderson's the main one. Like, he's went from a guy who was very much kind of flying under the radar to, in my opinion, he's one of the most entertaining guys on the scene right now. And he's doing great stuff for myself as well as doing South and Target. I think it's only a matter of time before he starts travelling about across the board.
So speaking of the dojo then, it's operates in the Iron Girders space, Iron Girders gym. I don't remember if I asked last time, but how was that kind of set up? Did you just approach the Iron Girders team wanting to take a class? How did you end up there?
Basically, after the Respect school closed down, I was essentially kind of left with like a group of guys, but nowhere to train them. So I kind of asked if I was able to kind of hold my class within their gym, which eventually kind of developed into the relationship that we've got now, where the dojo is a kind of, it's a part of Girders. It's essentially a class within the kind of Girders system. It's a good thing that we've got it. You know, it opens up more opportunities for the Girders guys as well, and as well as for my guys to get involved with the coaches there. Girders is one of the best facilities about, like, you know, as both a gym and as a, you know, as a wrestling school. So to have access to both of them like on a practically 24/7 basis, is, you know, invaluable for both sides. And getting to learn from so many different coaches for both sides as well is just, it can only ever be beneficial.
And Girders seems to run like 2-3 times a month, so even if you're able to get some of your guys into a King of the Fling or something like that, it just gets their reps in at the same time.
Yeah, already some of the guys have been like traveling across. Obviously, Ruby Roberts has wrestled there. Big Mick has been on Girders as well, so Stone Malone. I'm sure there's probably some other ones that I'm maybe forgetting. But yeah, there's already guys kind of crossing over. We've got Tommy Lockhart, who's one of the Girdles guys, appearing on Most Wanted in Paisley. So as I said, it's working well already.
And it's £5. Did you kind of price it? But not that I need to know your financials. But did you kind of price it because you know that the most people that are coming in are kind of they've done the training. Now it's more a case of the fine tuning and the character maybe that they need at the other end of the spectrum. How? Because £5, we've seen places charge some wild amounts for things, and you know, I think £5 rivals that quite nicely. But yeah, so how did you decide on like £5? Is it just because that's it just seems remarkably low.
Wrestlers are broke. it's never really been about money doing the training for me. I've had a lot given to me through wrestling. I feel like the least I can kind of do is give something back. And that's not just like some sort of marketing thing or something like that. Like genuinely, it's always been, I guess at least you call it a passion project. I just do it because it's good for me. It's good for my mental health. It's good for my own training. It keeps me busy. It keeps me sharp. It comes for a place of love, really. Maybe if I stop liking it so much, I'll maybe charge more. But no, for the foreseeable future, it'll stay at £5.
So I was going to say, if we see a big notice come up going now £7 or less, and I'm going, he's getting fed up of this. He's just he's got a lease to run out now. He's just got to get out of it. But yeah, it's just I hear nothing but good things about the dojo. And to be honest, I've had a little bit of praise on me for kind of keeping the Scottish wrestling scene kind of bubbling during the pandemic and everything. But
absolutely,
to be perfectly honest, you did a lot more beneficial work because you had the online dojo that just month to month you had these amazing names come in and they're always packed and everything as well. So I don't think anyone could question your passion for the wrestling scene if you've been nonstop. A pandemic didn't stop Luke King Sharp from providing some sort of teachable moments or some sort of wrestling content for everyone. It's just glad to end that sentence. I'm just keeping praise on you instead.
wrestling doesn't ever stop. Like the pandemic didn't mean that we had to stop learning, and there's still, you know, a community there, just like there is for any other sport. People were still interacting and talking about football. There's no reason that we couldn't interact and talk about wrestling. And people always say, like, you learn the most not in the wrestling schools, but driving to shows, and you know what I mean, just being around these kind of guys who have done it for a long time. And I totally agree with that, to be honest. You do learn so much more just being out there and being around guys who have been there and done it. So the best thing we can do if we can't get in the ring is be around guys who have been there and done it, and listen to their stories, listen to their advice, find out how they got to the dance.
And not only that, is when the shows did come back, you're everywhere. It seems like you don't switch off. Do you have time to do that, or are you always trying to get something in motion for Valor, something for yourself, something for the school, something for the merch table? Do you ever have a time to switch off?
I'd say honestly, it's pretty nonstop. I just said there's myself, there's Valor, there's the school, there's a merch table, there's UEWA on top of that. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff taking up a lot of my time and keeping me busy. But as I said, same with the school. It all comes from a place of love and a place of passion. And this is the lifestyle that I've committed myself to. I want to be in a place eventually where this is all that I do, and this is the path that you need to take. You need to spread out as much as possible and, you know, get into as many different kind of avenues as you can.
So speaking of that, then we'll talk about UEWA in a bit, because the merch table is something that I like. I like as a concept, because of course I did hear that you made a tidy wee profit on my my donation to the cause. Well, I say donation. I got a Blood Tourist t-shirt for the cause. But have you, when you set that up and you're seeing what people were wanting to get, what they're buying, did you find anything that was a bit like, oh, I didn't think that would be as popular, and now you've got to try and find more of these things? Or was there anything that kind of caught you by surprise?
Popular. I was quite surprised by that. Trading cards were really popular. And just generally kind of action figures, like some of the action figures are like really kind of sought after, I guess. And I had no idea how rare some of the action figures that we had, you know, turned out to be. But again, it's been fun. Obviously I'm a big collector myself, you can see behind me. So it's something that I enjoy. And something that, you know, I want to invest more time into. I feel, you know, you should spend as much time as possible doing things that you love. And wrestling's my big one, so I just try and spread it out as much as possible. Find as many different ways of doing it, and the merch table's turned out to be a pretty decent one.
Definitely trading cards. I don't know what it is. At the moment, I've kind of went through this thing where I want to get as many trading cards as I can for past guests of the podcast. And so that's my kind of thing now. So that's why I got you to sign one at Grand City Showdown. So I thought, well, I've got one looking sharp. Sweet. That's it. That was ticked off. And I've kept some aside for hopeful guests. Here's me thinking I'm going to get Piper Niven in the near future. You never know. It's possible. It's never say never. But it just seems it's a nice wee. I think it's because, you know, cost of living, people are living in smaller spaces. You could collect trading cards and they take up like no room. Like this shit takes up loads of room. but the trading cards, like I've got the wee, well, you saw it, the wee Wrestling Revolution wee pouch that came with the subscription. So I've got them all in there, nice and waiting for a Doug Williams interview so I could slide that one in. Got that signed years ago. Like put that in there as well. So yeah, it's just, yeah, you're right. And same with the podcast, and I'm sitting here most nights and thinking, oh, I want to get a guest on, and then I've got to try and get the rigmarole of actually getting someone to respond to me, and then trying to think, oh, I want to do this as well. And it is comes from a place of love where I'm thinking I could probably, I don't think Kelly would be happy with it, but I could quite happily, 8 o'clock every night, I would sit down for an hour and just chat with someone about wrestling or do something productive where I can talk about wrestling. It's just it's all consuming at this point in life, and it's safe. It's a safe thing to be consumed by. If you're yourself, you're doing it, but I'm sitting at a desk doing nothing. So the merch table is ace. People should go check it out. There's some wild, weird and wonderful and throwback stuff as well that I was going through it going, oh my god, I can't believe that people still have those. They haven't all been burned at some point.
So we got PS1 games, N64 games, like there's a lot of retro games, a lot of retro trading cards now as well, and you helped with that as well. And then the action figures as well. That's probably my favourite one to say. I do the same thing you're doing with the trading cards. I've kept a lot of the action figures of people that I've kind of worked with and stuff. That's probably my favorite one to kind of sell. I enjoy dealing with it.
I'm doing the same, kind of doing the same with the trading with the figures. If I go to a place and I can see like a Noam Dar, it's like, oh, I'll pick one of them up or something. I want to kind of get the wee Scottish set going. So yeah. At the moment, it's not going very well. I've got Drew there. That's it. That's as far as I've gone with the. With the collection, unless you want to count these wee custom Funkos in the corner, but it's fun. I think people realize that after the pandemic, where they're like, oh, what can we do that we enjoy? Collecting shit. Yeah, let's just collect shit. Let's just have a good time.
For sure.
So mentioned that before I got onto that, it was about UEWA. So you're one of the president of the UEWA.
So I'm the. It's also confusing. So I'm the European president of the AIWF, which is the board that's kind of above the UEWA. So Chaos from Denmark is the president of UEWA.
Right. Okay. So, how'd that happen? How did you end up as one of the presidents of AWF, of the European president?
So I was already obviously involved with UEWA. Basically, I felt like when I had the cruiserweight belt, I just felt like they had lost a lot of the prestige that they held before. The champions weren't getting to travel the same way that they used to. It used to be when you won that belt, like you got super busy and you would travel, you know, all over Europe. And that just kind of disappeared. Promotions fell off. The ones who were involved, you know, just didn't take much to do with it. They weren't really communicating with each other. I feel like a lot, basically all the communication involved with it broke down. It got to a point where, you know, people were reaching out to me because they didn't know who was in charge anymore. The guy who started UEWA had left wrestling and was pretty much unreachable. He wasn't on social media or nothing like that. But Kim Chaos was the guy that started up with him. There was the kind of two of them. So he just kind of inherited the role of running it. But again, I don't think he really had as much interest in it as myself. So I reached out to him and basically says, look, I'll take the reins with us. And I made sure it was after I lost the belt. Like I wasn't doing it for bookings or for like my own benefit. Mm-hmm. I thought this is something that's genuinely special, and there's just nothing being done with it. It'd be like a real shame to just see this fade away. And I thought, you know what, I'm traveling about Europe. I know enough places, but you know, 90% of them aren't involved with UEWA, and I'm sure that they would be if asked. So I kind of took the reins, but got a lot of new members involved. And things again started to pick up. We then joined up with AIWF, which is basically a very similar thing, but just on a much bigger scale. So they are international. They've got, you know, promotions in every continent, every livable continent is what they say. And it's mental, some of the places that they have promotions. Greg Anthony is the AIWF champion. He's been holding that for a year now. I believe he's from Georgia. I could be off. But yeah, he's been doing some really good stuff with the AIWF belt. But yeah, they were essentially competition. Like we were both trying to do the same thing. They were just doing it internationally. And we decided that rather than working, you know, essentially against each other, we would be better to join up. And we could become the European section of the AIWF. So instead of having AIWF in Europe, you have UEWA. And then internationally, you have AIWF. So yeah, it just made more sense to be, you know, the one unit. Because really what UEWA offers is a chance for talent and promotions to expand. It offers promotions, you know, a kind of access to wrestlers that they maybe wouldn't necessarily have heard of before, or wouldn't have been able to contact before. And for talent, it gives them an opportunity to contact these promotions, who are now going to at least feel a bit more familiar with them. If they are involved with another UEWA promotion, they can say, you know, they can say Valor, I work for Valor, and I'd like to come and wrestle in Denmark. And you know, for these promoters in Denmark, I say that UEWA should be like a seal of approval. You know what I mean? If they're coming from another UEWA promotion, then we know that they're good and they've came from, you know, a decent kind of background and stuff, and that they're able to work at a certain level. So it's all really took off.
And you just thought of throwing that in with everything else you got going on. So it sounds like a lot, not that there was any conscious thought, but there, like, was it last year? There was that whole thing about a UK Wrestling Council. You seem to have just kind of taken that idea, went, ah, fuck, I'm just going to do it internationally instead. And if you've If you work with these groups, then
the UK Wrestling Council. Yeah, you would be around since like 2009. It's been around for a long, long time before before I took it over. I'm just the idea wasn't mine. It was started long before me. I just seen something that I really enjoyed being part of. Was really proud of representing, and just didn't want to see it go to waste. I wanted it to continue for, you know, guys like my trainees. I want them to have that kind of same access and opportunities that I had.
You've added so many promotions to it, like to the point where now Scotland's kind of cut off for a little bit because they've kind of maxed out their allocation. But I was just seeing who else is in there, and more recently, WAW, Ricky Knight's promotion, the Knight's promotion has just been added onto it, and they've got quite an international, well-known promotion because of not only the Knights but because of Soraya. Hopefully, I'm saying that right, Soraya.
Yeah,
she will correct us, I'm sure. She has done on YouTube. I just forgot how it's pronounced, but so that's quite a big get to get in there. And are you finding that promotions are more open to that sort of thing now? Because we've seen things like W3L and now Progress On Demand, and promotions seem to be a bit more willing to work together now. I don't know if you were there pre-pandemic and to now. Have you seen it? That's evolved quite a lot.
Absolutely. Like, I think we went into the pandemic and came out with a different scene. People kind of feel like they kind of have to be willing to work together a bit more now. It's a struggle for everyone. I just said we are in the rebuilding process right now in British wrestling, I would still say. It's better for us to do that together instead of working against each other. Everyone's going to benefit more from it. The wrestlers are going to benefit more. The promoters are going to benefit more, and of course, the fans are going to see the benefit of it as well.
Yeah, because there was a time where, and it's still happening, but we can't really kind of focus on it too much. But there is places that are like, oh, if you work here, you can't work there, and that still happens. But yeah, it just seems like it's a lot more a case of, oh, you've worked here, okay, I know that you can do that, because why would they book you otherwise? And it's a nice little scene, but the amount of promotions that are in that. IWF in general internationally is insane. Any promotions that you'd like to try and get in there? Not that, unless you're already in negotiations with them, but Soft Ground. Want to get Soft Ground in there if you could.
So Soft Ground Wrestling we would definitely take them on. There's the Pro Wrestling Africa. Is the kind of the African side of the IWF stuff. There's already a kind of UEWA style group that they could get involved with. That would be cool. I don't really look for promotions in particular, I would say. I would say I more look at scenes. So recently, like, I wanted to get a Polish member. I thought the Polish scenes really kind of took off in recent years. I wanted us to be part of that. Germany was another one. Obviously, there's a history there where it was started essentially in Germany. So I always thought it was a shame that something that was started there had been kind of taken from that scene. They no longer kind of had access to it. So I wanted to get it back home. And I would say for one that we don't have, I would say France. I think there's a great scene in France. Guys like Tristan Archer and, you know, guys like that. Agile Blanc and stuff, Senza Volto. There's loads of brilliant French wrestlers that I would love to be part of the kind of UEWA mix. But generally, like, we want to be everywhere. We want as many scenes to be tied into this as possible, so that, you know, everybody involved can travel the world. You know what I mean? Can genuinely represent all of Europe. It's one thing calling yourself, you know, the European champion, but we want this, whoever holds those belts, to be, you know, the absolute best in Europe, and proving it by going scene to scene, country to country, and, you know, taking on top guys, much like you would have seen guys like Ric Flair doing in the NWA.
You mentioned France, and certainly since since Backlash. I think people are starting to maybe pay more attention to the crowd reaction in
Absolutely.
France. And was it Mike D? I think he's French. He was part of the TNA gut check that went through.
Yeah, French or Belgian, one of
Yeah,
the
Belgian. I think it was Belgian. Apologies to everyone in Bruges. But yeah, so yeah, there's just a bursting scene. And how do you find the time to try and, like I've mentioned, all the things that you're doing, I still scratch the surface. How do you find the time to pick up these scenes? Are you consulting with other members? Are you when you're with Robert Starr, for example, the current UEWA European Heavyweight Champion, Polish, if I remember rightly. So is he a guy that you kind of pick the brain of, going, right, where in Poland is kind of the best crowds, where's the best places to try and approach for this kind of thing?
Yeah, so I mean, naturally the members all we all communicate with each other. People suggest places that they work with. For example, Bleeding Gums have recently joined. They were already working with myself and W3L, so it made sense. And there's other examples of that kind of, and more internationally as well, places that'll work together and ask for somewhere to be brought in. But as well as that, obviously, I do my own kind of travels and stuff, and a lot of the places that have been brought in are people that I've met, from I go there and I've wrestled, I've seen the promotion for myself, and I know that it's what we're kind of looking for. It's not, this like totally open thing. I mean, we don't take just any promotion. So for me, at least going and working with these promotions, that's my kind of favored way of bringing them in, because then I know for myself exactly, who they are and what they can kind of bring to the table, and what we can bring them to as well. That's the kind of main way of doing it. And then of course, obviously, if you hear some buzz online, much like that's what I seen with Poland, was just so many guys going over there and wrestling and coming back and, saying good things about it, and then seeing the kind of footage and stuff as well. It just made me want to get involved.
I suppose as well, because wrestling is still a little bit of a still a seedy underbelly at times, and at least if you're there, you know who's the crew, who's working there, who's backstage, and then yeah, you get a good feel for it. Because for whatever reason, you go backstage to see someone who's maybe shouldn't be still around, and you go, well, that's them scratched off for the moment until they maybe get rid of that person or whatever. So yeah,
Absolutely.
it's interesting way to do it. It's probably the smartest way to do it, because people lie, and I think that's never going to change. Anyway, fun stuff. You mentioned Bleeding Gums, segueing like a pro here. Bleeding Gums, first primarily death match promotion in Scotland, as far as I'm aware. ICW did have their ways in their extreme insane insanity. But Bleeding Gums was, as soon as you did the Blood Tourist, and you like a little bit of the extreme ways of wrestling, was that no brainer when you were approached about Bleeding Gums, about being on there?
Yeah, absolutely. As soon as I heard there was a deathmatch promotion starting up in Scotland, I wanted to be part of it. I had a point to prove, you know what I mean? Like, for how many years? It feels like every tournament of death, there's a hashtag LKS for TOD. And I just, yes, as I said, as soon as I heard one, that style of wrestling was coming to this country, I was like, I'm gonna be part of that, and I'm gonna prove that I've kind of got what it takes to do this. But like you said, it's the first kind of all deathmatch promotion. Places like ICW, and there was, shows in the Classic Grand and stuff, and there's been hardcore wrestling, and there's been, of course, deathmatch wrestling in Scotland before, but not to this extent, not this many death matches, and not this violent. I mean, like, I'm not trying to blow my own horn, but I'd say I'm kind of considered as one of, the kind of at the forefront of deathmatch wrestling in this country, in Scotland. But when I first went out on Bleeding Gums, for a deathmatch against Big Joe, it was like, this is different. You know what I mean? I've been in a million different scenes, but I didn't think it would be wrestling and cuckoldy that kind of caught me off guard. But yeah, that crowd was different. It feels it's a bit more hostile in a sense. You know what I mean? The crowd feel a bit more violent. Like they know what they're there for. And there's an expectation to provide it. Then I'm happy to do so.
It's just I've had Andrew on a couple of times now, and every time I think I shave off a couple of years off my life expectancy, because it just gives me the fear of all the things that he speaks about. But when you said it was different, was there a part were you watching the show afterwards, after your match or before your match, where you watched it and went, I may have bitten off more than I can chew, when you're seeing like syringes and all that kind of stuff, and Tim Strange getting tattooed and all that kind of stuff, where you're just like, maybe this is maybe a bit too much.
Like, yeah, no, you know what I mean? I look at it and I think, wow, like I'm impressed that, you know, these guys are willing to put themselves through a lot more than what I was until recently, and a lot more than what I've seen a lot of people be willing to do in there. But at the same time, I might not have been a deathmatch wrestler for a long time, but I was no stranger to risk, you know, putting myself in harm's way. So I'm always willing to take a calculated risk, and yeah, deathmatch wrestling is exactly that for me. I know what I'm getting myself in for, and I know what I'm capable of as well. You know, I don't think I'm ever going to put myself in a situation where I don't feel like I'm gonna come out well on the other end. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I wouldn't do that. I thought to be stupid. Of course, naturally you do see some of that kind of stuff with deathmatch wrestling, where it's like, well, that's just not needed. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I feel I'm still willing to go out and push the boundaries just as far as anybody else, maybe even more so.
But it is a fascinating scene. It's like I've never written it off. There's clearly an audience, and there's a audience for it, and they're rabid, and they know what they want to see, like you said. But no, I'm just gonna give it another mention, and we'll talk about deathmatch stuff. Alton Thorne's weapon of choice still sends shivers down my spine with nettles and that. That's just that's still. You could give me weed whackers. You could give me glass, barbed wire of any description, but nettles is still the line where I'm like, no, that's too. No, that's it. I'll take tattoos over it. That's it. No, it's chemical warfare. That's what that is. It's just oh man. Anyway,
I wouldn't be keen. But that's not me saying that Alton Thorne's got my number. I'll come out with the biggest fucking weed whacker he's ever seen.
You'll be scouting the place beforehand, going, right, is there any docking leaves about, just to make sure you know exactly where to run afterwards.
That'll figure it out.
Oh god, I don't know why I keep mentioning it, because it just gives me the fear. I've got to get Alton Thorne on, I think, because I know that I'm going to speak to him, and he's going to be really lovely for an hour.
Yeah,
and I'm going to
a great guy.
But speaking of something completely different, then we'll just take an absolute left hand turn into Grado's wrestling, big family wrestling bash, where you got to tag team with Scrubber Daily.
Yeah. that was an experience. That was cool, and that's the pendulum of wrestling, isn't it? Where, you know, you're swinging from death matches with and bleeding gums and going out and, you know, half killing yourself, and then it swings back and you're in the pavilion with Scrubber Daly. He's, you know, he's playing the role of your dad. You know, and you're rolling about a swimming pool and everything else at the end. So that was a lot of fun. I'm really grateful that I got to be involved with Scrubber Daly as well. He's one of the guys, obviously, that kind of laid the foundations for British wrestling. He was Giant Haystack's tag partner. Do you know what I mean? That's mentally think. So it's an honor to get to tag with one of the legends of the game. It's not often, like, you know, something like that will come up, and especially, you know, not in such an iconic venue as the Pavilion. Anytime you get to wrestle in the Pavilion, it's like Captain Holt Brooklyn Nine is vindication, because you know you're like that. This is where I wanted to be. You know what I mean? I wanted to be on these kind of stages, on these level of shows. You know what I mean? Especially as maybe more so if you're from Glasgow. It might be different for somebody like from here. But for me, that's one of my earliest memories of wrestling, was seeing wrestling in the Pavilion, and not even that, seeing like the pantomimes in the Pavilion and just like daft stuff. Getting to actually perform there and see my own face, like, on, you know, posters on the side of the building, you know, having my family mention that to me, you know, that blows my mind. So it's always a big, big honour to get to wrestle in the Pavilion.
Yeah, like you're saying, the pendulum, you go from that to then deathmatch stuff, and then over to, well, you're in Denmark, I think, like the weekend before the match with Team of Scrubber Daily, and by your own 6 degrees of separation from the Devon Dudley, who you beat. I don't know if anyone's mentioned it, but that means you've tagged essentially with Giant Haystacks in your.
It does, and I'm sure I've probably beat Big Daddy as well.
That's it. Yeah. So
we can figure it out, but I'm sure I've beat Big Daddy.
I love that logic, because it makes me laugh every time when I see you face a bit like Devon Dudley comes back out wrestling or whatever, he does a move, I'm like, Looking Sharp's beating him, so you know. Essentially he's beating the New Day now, so that's how it works.
Is that kind of wrestler question where, you know, who'd he ever beat? Well, Andre the Giant, WrestleMania 3.
Oh yeah, you've done this, haven't you? You've went back as far as you possibly could to beat everyone, have you?
Devon does. I thought I'd already did this. I thought that's what you're talking about.
So oh, yeah, Devon
beat Jeff Hardy. Jeff Hardy beat Triple H. Triple H beat Hulk Hogan. Looking Sharp beat Andre the Giant at WrestleMania 3.
Do you take requests if someone just sends you a wrestler as a comment? Are you able to work your way back and just go, I beat him. I'm lineal with beat him.
I've beaten the world.
Is there anyone that's like your pivot point, just on that? Like you start with Devon Dudley, obviously, and then is there anyone that you think, right, if I get them, I'm safe? Hogan, I'm good guess. Once you get back to Hogan, you're pretty much safe.
Triple H beat everybody.
Mm, true.
If they were ever in WWE, they probably got beat by Triple H at some point. But at least if they were in WWE at a certain time, they probably got beat by Triple H at some point. Hogan's another good one. But those are the pivot points, I guess. And once you can get to Triple H, you're on the way to Andre.
So if anyone learns anything, again, if you missed the last time we were on a podcast together, Looking Sharp's beating everyone. Linearly. He just has, okay? I'm not gonna use a word I can't say. So from there then, we should probably speak about things that you've got coming up a little bit, because we've chatted for near 50 minutes and there's still things that you've got coming up that are very exciting and very interesting as well, with Valor.
Absolutely.
and Bleeding Gums, but we'll start with Backlash. That seems like a good place to start, as it's this weekend. I'm going to put my wee light on here just to light up the place, just to spotlight it. Backlash, 16th of June, taking place at the Grand Ole Opry in Glasgow. So, speak about the venue first. So, from what I've heard, like I said, probably much like the Pavilion, I'm not from Glasgow, so I don't know the significance of the Grand Ole Opry. What is it about that place specifically? It looks amazing from all the pictures I've seen.
Nowhere else like it in Europe. It is wholly unique. It's got history behind it, much in the same vein as these places that you mentioned, Pavilion, maybe like the Kings, the Citizens, places like that. For me, at least, I would think of it along the same kind of veins. These kind of iconic buildings in Glasgow, like, you know, even if you've never been in, you recognise the outside of it with the neon lights and stuff, and it is absolutely gorgeous. And you know, it's been used for films and music videos, and you know, it's been used for, you know, big concerts. People who came, you know, Noel Gallagher and stuff have played at the Opry. So it's a fantastic venue, and it's just made for wrestling. You know what I mean? Like when I think of like the stereotype of wrestling, and I think when anyone thinks the stereotype of wrestling, when you watch The Simpsons and there's wrestling, it's slam bang Western style, kind of, you know what I mean, Southern wrestling. And yeah, that's what I wanted to kind of bring to the Opry. It's like we've got, you know, all this kind of Americana in the Opry. Well, why not professional wrestling? And when I showed up, they've got this massive light above the ring, where the ring would go. And it's for when they were gonna do boxing shows there back in the '70s, and it just never happened. So this big, like, it's a ring light. That's what it was for. It was installed for rings, and it's never been used. So we're gonna be using that at upcoming events, hopefully. That will give it a kind of even more of a kind of old school feel to it. But it's just a fantastic venue. I believe it's like £1.80 a pint. Like that alone is a reason to visit the Opry. The rolls and sausage at a wrestling show. Who else is doing it like this? Do you know what I mean? But aye, it's a brilliant venue. And Soul Man Kyle Wallace, the ring announcer, he described it to me as turning into our Hammerstein Ballroom, which just kind of filled me with pride, to be honest. Because that's exactly what I want it to be. We had no idea that we were going to be doing as many shows at the Opry as what we're doing. I mean, we're doing the 16th of June, and then we're back on the 7th of July. We were there last month as well. We're going to be back in October. So they're just coming nonstop, and people are enjoying them. People are loving the shows, and as long as people are loving them, we're going to keep bringing them. And the Opry is probably my favorite venue in wrestling.
So from pictures I've seen of it, it gave me like a roadhouse vibe to it. You'd expect there's going to be a cooler outside that's going to come in and chuck folk out if they get a bit too rowdy and stuff like that. It just looks so different to anything else in the UK, certainly. Well, it's definitely in Scotland, from the places I've been. It's a town hall. It's definitely a bit
more... it gives it like a setting. It feels like a, you know, like a level in a video game, you know what I mean? It's cool, especially with the saloon kind of bar in the background and stuff. And as I said, I love the neon lights. Somewhere eventually I want to do like the big drone shot of like outside the venue and stuff. Because when everything's all lit up at night, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's probably my favorite venue in wrestling.
So tickets are hopefully limited by the time that we're actually putting this episode out on the 10th. But tickets are available through eventbrite.com. There'll be links everywhere on social media. Doors open 1:30 p.m. VIP, 2 p.m. for general, bell time about 2:30. So this is going to be the Sunday after, well, the Sunday following WWE's Clash at the Castle. And you didn't fall into the trap of using a very obvious logo or name to get a letter through the door to cease and desist it. So we've got Backlash.
You can thank, I'm not gonna take credit for that. You can thank Mike Russo for that. If it was up to me, I'd have put John Cena on the poster.
but all we know that he is on the poster. Yeah, you can't see him.
Backlash was Mike's idea. In fact, this is totally like off topic, but it's a funny story, so I'm going to tell you just because I said about putting John Cena on the poster. I did it while I was in China. We did a tour of like shopping malls, almost. They were like furniture shopping malls. We show up to the venue, and they got this big banner, and it's got John Cena, Triple H, Hulk Hogan, and The Undertaker SmackDown versus Raw 2007 render. And so we're all laughing, taking pictures of it and everything. The promoter's like, no, who did this? I didn't know about this. It's like, we go inside and the entire shopping mall is just covered in these pictures of like Undertaker SmackDown render. and like Roman Reigns, John Cena, and everything. But instead, they were getting me and Rob Sharp, and both at least I guess he's kind of closer to a WWE star than one of us. But I just absolutely love the brass neck of that, and only in China would you get that.
And you're standing there going, "Beat him, beat him, beat him."
Yeah, absolutely. Beat every him. Single one of them.
Oh, love it. We must have spoke about your China adventures in our last episode.
Yeah,
people can go and check that out. Must have.
That's in the app.
So we'll talk about your Valor side of things then, because we spoke with Andrew about the time only one match was announced for the Bleeding Gum side of things. So for those that haven't actually went on social media at all, somehow. Their match they've announced is UK Deathmatch Championship in a home run derby and buckets of pain match. I don't know what that means, but it's going to be terrifying.
I'm not sure either, but I'm sure it's going to be entertaining.
I'm feeling that it's going to be involving some sort of baseball bats and something. But it's supposed to be, even Andrew's own admission was saying that it's like, it's as family friendly as it can get kind of thing.
Yeah.
Like, it's on that line as far as it can go. In that, but it's Michael Caden defending against Tim Strange and Dean Ford, who's grabbed some headlines recently of the old social media.
Yeah,
we'll leave that aside for a little bit because I think it's a whole thing that we probably shouldn't get into because one of us will say something that'll harm something.
Oh, cool. Someone will
be offended. Either side of the barrier. So we'll just.
Oh, well, if you're a bald guy with a beard, so you should get the glasses as well and just enter it as like, you should be the fun man.
I'm the infamous Billy. That's it.
That's it. We've already done it. You're the infamous Billy Strachan.
I actually might have some circle glasses somewhere, sunglasses somewhere.
There you go.
If I find them, I might just see if I can get Ian and Ian together and just.
And
just
what happens then when this turns into a tag team with a manager?
They go, book me. I need bookings. I've got a big car bill that coming up. Please book me. Or sign the Patreon. Patreon.com/ScottResnet. Anyway, the Valor side of things. You've announced two matches. We'll start with the one that you're not in. Probably a good place to go. But it's probably all the regrets that Fulton King in the world's going to have when he takes on BT Gunn. I'm sure this is an opponent that Fulton's wanted for, either he's had before or he's wanted for a very long time. So, when it's putting the best on what Valor can offer, because you'll be back there the next month, was this a match you were like, you wanted to see yourself, or one that you thought that you had to be on this card?
I wanted it to be the best of Valor. We've only got two matches, and I want people to see what they most associate with Valor. And I would say Legends Never Die are a big part of that. BT Gunn, of course, is as well. And I thought Fulton was the kind of the perfect contender for him because he's been competing on an international level that no one else in this country really has been. Obviously, I've been kind of going there with him, but he was recently in Mexico with myself. I am taking on absolutely world-class talent and not looking at a place for a second. I've done training with Lucha Libre training. Everything's on the other side. It's you know, imagine being right-handed and trying to do everything with your left. It's, you know, everything in American and Americanized wrestling is on the left side, and, you know, everything's on the right in Mexico. It's like mirrored, and he just flourished. He did so well. And I thought, you know, coming back, you know, let's give him the ball, essentially. Let's put him in BT Gunn, one of the, you know, probably the best talent in Europe, in my opinion. And let's show the world what I've seen. I've seen him do it in Denmark. I've seen him do it in Sweden. He won the Copenhagen Cup. Absolutely tore the house down in Malmo. You know, he's been doing it in the Opera against myself and Deccan, and, you know, and Kirk and Tillich as well. So let's put him on a big stage in the Opera, and let's do it with BT Gunn, and let's show the Glasgow scene what we've got. We've got one of the best heavyweight wrestlers in the UK right now, and he's ready to go.
And yeah, it's probably maybe fit in somehow Mexico in a bit, but we'll carry on with Backlash before we start tangenting all over the place. So the other match that you've announced for that, your second one for Valor, is God's Country, Stone Malone and Frank Cross. Is still Frank of the Cross, or is he Frank Cross again?
Of the Cross.
Frank of the Cross, if I get right, with Sister Veronica against yourself and Kyger as Glasgow Grindhouse.
Yeah.
This is going to be a big brawl, isn't it?
It always is. It always is. I'm not a wrestler, I'm a fighter. That's what I'm talking about. Everything comes from a place of passion, but you can't go in and lock up with a guy when you're coming to a place of passion. You're too fully adrenaline, too ready to go. But yeah, as I said, I want people that are associated with Valor. The first name you mentioned when you said characters in Valor was God's Country. There's a reason for that. People remember them. They're entertaining and they're good at what they do. They're imposing. The song, people love the song as well. Everything about the presentation is fantastic. Sister Veronica has came absolutely out of nowhere. Like, what a promo. What an entertaining character. Like, and she's been standing backstage with a mic the whole time. It blows my mind that nobody has put her, you know, in front of the audience before in a performing role. Because she absolutely knocked her out of the park. Frank of the Cross is, I'd say, you know, one of the most versatile wrestlers in Europe. For God's sake, the guy has been a Roman soldier, a Russian, an action hero, a cowboy, a preacher, an American preacher, and the list goes on. Stone Malone's one of the most entertaining young trainees, you know, going right now. He's absolutely blown up. He's a shooting star, and Tim Strange is, for me, he's our Andre the Giant. You need to come and see the size of this guy yourself. He's enormous. This guy's a heavyweight wrestler. This is a Stan Hansen style cowboy. Like, Tim Strange is the realest cowboy the Opry's ever seen. I put my house on that.
The best thing about, because I had Stone Malone on recently, an episode that's going to come out in a couple of weeks. Also, all that being said, absolutely, cowboy hats are cool as well. I think we had a very long, a far too long discussion that cowboy hat, if you see a cowboy hat, it automatically makes you cool. It's just that's the rules. Cowboy hats are just cool.
I'd still say there's not enough cowboys in wrestling. Even with the cowboy faction.
Are you always on the lookout for another guy just like mentally sketching a cowboy hat on them, going, I should get them in touch with God's Country just to see.
It's kind of like that stereotype where it's like, oh, you know, WWE love, you know, big sweaty jacked guys looking sharp, fucking loves a cowboy hat.
Yeah, they're just cool. It's nothing. It's just got, they've got everything that you want. They've got a little bit you can put your finger to throw it on. It's just, I need a cowboy hat. The only one I've got is one from Buffalo Bills, and that was at Disneyland. And it's not the same. It's a straw hat. It's not right. It needs to be a proper up the sides cowboy hat going on. So I'm just gonna write that down as investing in cowboy hat for next year. So that's two matches for girders. I've written down a note that says girders because the dojo's there and I've got myself confused. But that's two matches for Valor for 16th. So if people go and check that out, W3L's matches will probably be announced in the interim between me recording this episode and putting it out. So yeah, it'll already be out of date. So oh well.
They're going to bring us a special episode of Wrestling Showdown for Backlash.
So literally will be. Because that'll go out on Sunday, and this will go out on Monday. So yeah, go check out WCDL Wrestling Showdown, and to find out what matches are coming up for that. Speaking of W3L, then for a second, you're still embroiled in a rivalry with Mike Musso. And it's went all over the country. It's went through dog collar matches, and now it's possibly, maybe, perhaps going to end at Resolution in a steel cage.
I would imagine it has to. Like, how much further can we go? We've been tied up with dog collars. We've had more no holds barred, no rules matches than I can count at this point. And the steel cage is the ultimate decider in wrestling, really. You know, two guys are gone in and one guy's coming out. Whoever's left in there is going to be, you know, a kind of shell of the person they went in as. And for me, I know that I'm capable of handling that situation. I've been in that situation numerous times. You know, the blood tourist isn't a moniker. It's a statement. It's what I do around the world. I go all over the world and put myself in the most violent situations possible in order to prove what I'm capable of. Whereas Mike Musso has done the exact opposite. He's put himself in the promoter's seat and stayed around his own kind of bubble, his own kind of mates, working with his own kind of guys. And he's not willing to step out of that bubble. He's not willing to put himself in those violent situations. And honestly, I think it's because he knows that these days he's past it and he's not got it. He's not capable of handling a match like that anymore. And honestly, I feel more sorry for his wife and his two young boys than I do for him, because he was cowardly enough, and he was enough of a joke of a father to put himself in that situation where he's no longer going to be able to provide for their win. So I feel bad for them, but I don't feel bad for him for what I'm going to do.
And I've just realised from the date that is going to be this weekend. So I'm gonna make sure that people hear those words before the match actually happens. This weekend, 2 p.m. and bell time 2:45. Tickets still available for Resolution at the Ice Arena in Fife. So we'll make sure that Mike Musso hears that. And I don't know whether it's going to send him back into his shell a little bit more, or it'll fire him up a little bit.
Never heard before. It's whether it's going to sink in.
We'll get that made sure that it's clipped out and ready for people to hear. Going forward then, a little bit, we're going to go into 30th of June. That is the Valor for Most Wanted. So we won't break down all the matches. There's 8 matches on this card, so people go check out social media and they can find out full card. It's going to take place at a venue in Paisley. Doors open 6:30, bell time 7. Tickets will hopefully, again, be limited by the time that we put this out, but eventbrite.com is where you can find out more. I think the big story with this one is the return of Chris Renfrew at the last show, and it's going to end up being the New Age Click against Glasgow Grindhouse is the first part of this story. This is the winner picks stipulation for your next match. Chris Renfrew coming back to wrestling, that's something that was very shocking to see, because I think by possibly everyone's admission, probably never thought we'd see Chris Renfrew in a wrestling ring again. So yeah, talk us through that a little bit.
I was just as shocked as anybody to see Chris Renfrew back in a wrestling ring. And if Chris Renfrew had reached out under normal circumstances, Chris Renfrew would have been more than welcome in a Valor ring, because, you know, you need to know your enemy. And I know fine well that he was absolutely one of the best, you know, talents around that time that we were talking about earlier, that, you know, that peak of British wrestling. He was one of the guys at the very top of that, and he was one of the guys that got it off the ground and took it as high as it went. He was an asset backstage as a writer and in a creative role. And he was an asset in the ring as well. He was very entertaining on the mic. He had a huge following, a very loyal following for the NEK. But really, you're seeing an entirely different Renfrew. I guess even the NEK, although I was never aligned with them, I definitely always had a lot of respect for the NEK, and I knew exactly what they were capable of. But this is a whole new Chris Renfrew. And we can see that with the way that he and his members are presenting themselves now. Of course, we've had the first reveal as well, being Cavaro. So it's a whole new crew. And as much as, you know, we've not seen Renfrew for 6 long years. It's something different that's come out at the other side of this wait. And I don't honestly know how much I can say on him because I don't really know what to expect from him. It wasn't predictable 6 years ago, and he's not became any more predictable in that time. But I guess the only advantage that I have is that I've been fighting Chris Renfrew for over 10 years now. I came into this game fighting Chris Renfrew. When I first showed up my ICW, it was Chris Renfrew that I took on, and the second and third. And many other times after that, Pro Wrestling Elite, we fought up and down Scotland through England. And we'll do it again. This will be the ultimate decider. As much as he might think that this is, you know, this new path for him, this new venture, this new NEK, the one thing that's coming back to bite him on the arse is that I'm finally sick of him. I've finally had enough, and he's gonna be gone for a lot longer than 6 years than when Luke King Sharp and the rest of the Valor roster are finished with him. Because this isn't ICW, this isn't, you know, any of the other promotions that he worked for before. Valor and Luke King Sharp aren't to be fucked with.
A man that's possibly cleaned up in some ways, but it's left him even more bitter coming back to the wrestling scene. It's gonna be, yeah. I didn't expect it. I saw the little teaser and I was like, no, it's not Chris Renfrew. And then, sure enough, it was Chris Renfrew. So this is just mind blowing. We'll see how it all plays out with yourselves and the New Age Click in the future. For the rest of the card, we've got God's Country in action against Legends Never Die. Again, that's going to be absolute.
That's good. Wild.
We've got Tommy Lockhart in action, Charlie Anderson, Sakiba Ali, Triple Threat, which sounds amazing. I really like Tommy Lockhart's look. The whole like vaudevillain kind of thing going on. I think it's just ace. I'm always, much like a cowboy hat, I'm sold on a handlebar moustache as well.
People don't realise how long Tommy Lockhart's been around for as well. Tommy Lockhart was Tommy Marks before, who people may remember from...
Have you? I remembered that name. I didn't realise it's the same guy. Jeez.
Yes, he went away. He's a fireman now, and he's came back. He's got a whole new presentation.
Bloody hell. Right, and elsewhere we've got Daisy Jenkins and Ruby Roberts. They've been going back and forth everywhere, it seems, at the moment. Robin Romero in rare singles action against Seb Silvers, which is great. Stone Malone and Sebastian Day, just throw a bull rope match in there. Why not? It's God's Country match. Rules. Eastern Block, Jan Islav and Crowbar taking on Mike Musso and Adam Shame. That's modern meeting the veteran, the past and present, I suppose, a little bit with that.
Absolutely.
Kind of thing.
The Eastern Blocker, I cannot wait for people to see the reaction that Eastern Bloc get. Not just they get a great reaction in Scotland, but in Scandinavia, you like the crazy over. And I could not, with all of my years as a booker and, you know, wrestler and everything else, I never thought it would be the pseudo Soviet Union that got super over, but here we are.
I know, especially was it the first episode you put out of CCW, and it was the first 10 minutes was a promo about immigration from Eastern Bloc.
10 minute immigration promo for all the 6-year-olds in fucking town. But the plights of homelessness and immigration.
They're sitting there going, I've got an inflatable hammer. I want to hit you. Just come on.
It felt like that South Park episode. They took our jobs.
And last but not least is Lou Nixon, who you've become very aware of, very up close and personal recently, against Buffa. Of course, we know Buffa.
That is two world class wrestlers. Like, Lou Nixon has been tearing it up all over America. I am, and a lot in the New York scene where Buffa, you know, made his name, established himself. He's went out to Japan. He's learned a kind of martial arts based style, which obviously Lou Nixon, you know, came into wrestling with. And I just think this is going to be absolutely, you know, this is going to be a world beater, this one. If there's any match that you're coming to this show to see, it should be this one, because they're going to absolutely blow the roof off the place.
Oh, incredible lineup there. We mentioned Mike Musso just a second ago, and it popped into my head that I've got to mention it, because it was after our last chat. It was you in W3L is so energetic. There's so much energy going on, tension, that it even broke the lighting in Elgin Town Hall when you had your match. I think it was Taylor Bryden. You and Taylor Bryden had a match, and it broke the lights at one point. I think Mike Musso came at the end to beat you. Hopefully I'm not misremembering this match entirely. I'm sure it was you and Taylor Bryden.
Anyway, that sounds right.
Yeah, that was amazing. It's just because you guys have been wrestling for so long that lights going out is probably the least of your concerns and worries. You're like, it's fine. I'll just keep going.
We have been wrestling for forever, and as much as I've got to say about Mike as a person, he's very, very talented in the ring. He's very underrated, I'd say. I'd say he really, really hasn't been given his flowers for everything that he's done for the Scottish scene in the past. And you know, as a performer, you know, working for Valor, he's always put on very, very entertaining matches. As I said, I've obviously got my own kind of personal feelings for him, but I've very, very much enjoyed making a profit off his hard work.
That was just an amazing night from memory. And yet, and you still ended up in your pants on the stage again. I don't know how it happens. It just keeps happening. Anyway, on to Valor.
Aston Embroiderer has been providing my gear, so that's he's the man to blame. He obviously thinks looking sharp, bigger around the hips than he is.
He's weighting it down. He's weighting the embroidery on. The patches have got like little weights in them. So, back to Valor, Night of the Opry, 7th of July. You know, keeping yourself busy, not just content with wrestling everywhere across the Europe and the world, headed to Mexico. You've got trying to kind of circumnavigate. I feel like you're like in Always Sunny when Charlie Day has got the pinboard when he's looking for Pepe Silva. I feel like that might be you some days, where you're just going, we've got all these shows going on, and then I've got this and I've got that going on. I've got this to organise and this as well. I get that vibe from you. I don't know whether it's accurate or not, but we'll.
I definitely got to get myself a big map.
I just tick off where you've been.
Yeah, for sure.
Grand Ole Opry is getting taken over again. July 7th, the Night of the Opry event. There's several matches announced for that. 5 from my gathering of information. Including, we've got Buffa versus Yanislav. Now, Jan seems to be your breakout guy in Valor. He seems to be the one that's just grabbing all the opportunities as he can get them. And then going up against Buffa, that's a hell of an opportunity in itself.
Absolutely, and I think he's going to thrive in there against an American. I know the Eastern Bloc certainly aren't keen on the USA, so I think that's going to be a very kind of interesting clash there. But he's been in there with Robert Starr. He competed for the UEWA heavyweight title, and something that people don't know is that originally wasn't gonna go on last at Ring of Fire. There was we had to change the card around, and that needed to go on last, and he was given the ball and he ran with it. He stepped up and he put in a match that wouldn't have been out of place in the main event of any card, and he's been doing that around the world. He's been coming to Sweden. I think Jan has probably wrestled abroad every single month this year, at least once, and he's been in a big feud again. Can't wait for everybody to see it once the footage and stuff does go live. But he's been having a big feud with a guy called Eli Hush, who is going to blow your minds when you see him as well. He's an absolutely world-class talent. I believe he's Qatari Swedish. He's absolutely fantastic. I mean, him and Jan have just been tearing it up. They're going to be blowing it off, much like Mike, me and Mike's cage match. They're blowing off their rivalry next month in a I Quit match. So that's probably the only bigger decider than a cage match has got to be an I Quit match, because you know you really need to degrade your opponent in a sense, and you know what way to prove that you're the bigger man than to make them say in front of a live audience that they can't take it anymore. Eli Hush is a mime as well. For Jan to, you know, Jan's gonna have to make Eli Hush go against everything that he believes in, and he's gonna have to make him speak and say that he quits. I think Jan's gonna have to put in more of a fight than he ever has before for that one. And you know, taking on Buffer on the lead up to that, I don't know if it's the wisest decision on his part. Because Buffa has been absolutely tearing it up all over the world. Like, he recently went back home to America, and has been, you know, revisiting a lot of the promotions where he started, taking on guys like Leo Sparrow, who has been making a big name for himself in the American indie scene, which I'm really happy to see as well, because he was one of the guys who was on the online dojo, came to a lot of those, Went back to Japan as well. Did the Gaijin Muscle Tag Team again. Big Dylan, can't remember his last name. But yeah, put on fantastic matches there. And Buffard's just one of those guys that he's been around for 20 plus years, but he just gets better with age. Every time I see him, he's just getting smoother and smoother in the ring. And he's just been absolutely world class for, you know, plus two decades now.
Is Jan someone that you kind of see yourself in? Because when I spoke to Jan for the podcast, he's just such this ball of passion. He loves wrestling. He loves what he does. And he loves that he can bring in the things that he loves in. He loves his movies and movie references and all that kind of stuff. Is he a guy that you kind of see? I mean, you're still ridiculously young, but when you look at Jan, do you look at him and go, that's a young looking sharp kind of thing going on?
Jan's older than me, but
yeah,
but yeah, 100%. As soon as I met him, I could feel the passion, you know, from him. I knew how much he loved it, and I knew how much he wanted it, and that's what I want for the dojo. Like, we were talking about, you know, why is it £5? I don't want your money. I want your hard work. I want your dedication, and in return, I'm gonna give you everything in my arsenal to make your, you know, make it possible for you, make it happen. So when I first met Jan, I could tell that he was really passionate. I agree with what you're saying. He's super kind of charismatic, entertaining. And I knew that there was more of a character in there. He's very, very patriotic about being, you know, being Slavic. Obviously he was a Slavic one for a long time. And I thought there's something in there that we can have fun with. I thought Crowbar is the perfect guy to, you know, guide him as well. Can I keep him cool? You know what I mean? And Crowbar's been brilliant with them. The two of them have really, really done something special with Eastern Bloc. They've became, you know, one of the faces of Valor. For me, that's what you come to see at Valor. Like, I got offered, I'm not gonna sit and like drop names, but I got offered a lot of big international names, guys who've been on TV and stuff for like opera shows and stuff, and honestly, I've just kind of—I'm not saying I'll never do it, but I've just kind of been like, "Well, why spend all this money bringing in all these, you know, big names when people want to see Eastern Bloc, people want to see God's Country, and we're getting good crowds with these guys." So I personally would rather invest in, you know, guys like Jan, because guys like Jan are invested in Valor as well. As you said, he's totally in love with the game. And you know, if he's gonna do the work for me, I'm gonna do it for him.
I mean, the only exception, of course, to trying to bring in international names is if the Dudleys want to Devon wants to try and get his win back then it's Dudley's versus Glasgow Grindhouse. Has to be done.
Devon chance. One and done. Maybe Bubba can try, but Devon was one and done. Devon's beat. No rematch.
Fair enough. Elsewhere, we've got Seb Silver versus Jordan Side.
Jordan Side.
Oh, I'm getting good at this. God's Country in full force. Tim Strange, Frank Cross, Frank of the Cross, damn it. And Stone Malone, the Sister Veronica, taking on Seb Silver's Legends Never Die. Again, just this is going to be wild, chaotic. Mike Musso, Jack Harrop in a hardcore match. Mike's beaten up his dad before, so that's going to be
exactly.
Going to be interesting, to say the least. And BT Gunn versus Lou Nixon, which, God, that's going to, God help everyone's chest and skin in general.
That is going to be violent professional wrestling. And both guys are excited for that match. As soon as I put that match up, I got messages from both guys that night talking about that match. These guys are both going in here with a point to prove, you know what I mean? They're both known as two of the hardest hitters in the game, not in the UK or Europe, period. These guys are brutal in there. I've wrestled both of them, I tell you, first-hand experience. These guys will knock shit out of you. I'm sorry if I keep swearing. These guys will knock sideways. They are two of the absolute best on any roster, on any show. It blows my mind how they aren't, you know, signed to a WWE or an AEW or somewhere that can pay them a lot more money than Valor Wrestling can, because they are absolute world-class talents.
So that's five matches announced so far. More to come, no doubt. So keep an eye on Valor's social medias. That's doors open 5:30 for VIP, 6 p.m. general, 6:30 bell time approximately. Tickets available at eventbrite.com. Go for a night at the Opry. Why not? It's going to be a good time on the 7th of July. So that's all the Valor stuff that we could talk about at the moment. Before we get onto the fan questions, we've got Bleeding Gums on July 20th at the Ice Factory in Perth.
Yes.
We've started our journey speaking about wrestling at the Ice Arena in Fife, to end it with the Ice Factory in Perth. Almost like I planned it that way. You're in a match with Dean Ford. With the infamous Dean Ford in a Holiday from Hell death match. So you find out firsthand, you were the first person to find out about the infamous Dean Ford up close and personal via a chair. Dean Ford's a guy you've known a long time and seen wrestle, and probably wrestled more times than you care to remember. But Holiday from Hell death match. Do you know what to expect? Have you already got ideas?
You never know what to expect when it comes to Bleeding Gums. I don't think it's going to be as much fun as the 420 death match was. I think this one's gonna be a bit more violent. And you're saying that I've known Dean for a long time, and I have. I've wrestled Dean, you know, a million times. Me and Dean came through together. But I don't know this guy that he's showed up as. I don't know who he's trying to be. But it's not the guy that I came up with. He's certainly presenting himself as having being a lot more violent and a lot more honed in. I was already aware of how violent Dean was before this. Dean's a very decorated, legitimate fighter. He's, you know, got a big background in kickboxing. I've got a big respect for that. So if he sees himself as even more violent, then it's definitely something that I need to be ready for. But at the same time, Dean sure caught me off guard from behind, and that is what it is. But when the bell goes in that match, whatever a Holiday for Hell death match may be, when that bell goes, it's deathmatch wrestling. It's not kickboxing. There is no rules. We're not going to have pillows on our hands or pillows on our heads or on our legs to protect us. It's balls to the wall, deathmatch wrestling, as violent as you can get. Call it kumite if you want to be martial arts about it. This is a deathmatch. And somebody is going in there and getting hurt, and it's not going to be me. So Dean can throw kicks as high as he likes. He can, you know, he can use all of the training and everything else that he's learned over the years. But I do not honestly think it's gonna matter when it comes in there and it's life or death, because I won't be dying in the Ice Factory.
So this is an outdoor event for Bleeding Gums Wrestling. Go to bleedinggumswrestling.co.uk to find out more about your tickets. Doors open 3:30, bell time 4 p.m. So outdoors. I think there's a barbecue and everything. This sounds like a hell of an event.
Yeah.
That you're going to batter Dean Ford in. I miss Ford when he went by 4D for like 2 months. And I thought, that's so clever. And it took me, it probably didn't take me as long. You probably still have people coming up to you now going, oh, looking sharp, it's a pun.
Yeah.
It took me way longer than it should have been when I was going, why has he called himself 4D? Why has he called himself 4D? Ford. It's Ford. Ah. Halcyon days. Anyway, right. So that's Plated Gums got coming up. We do have some couple fan questions. First one from Kirsten Louise, photography. Just asking if you can still believe you can fly. So this has been back in January when you made your triumphant return to WrestleZone for Granny City Showdown. For anyone keeping score, took over an hour and a half before I mentioned WrestleZone. we took on Mickey Vago. Amazing return. Battle of the dungarees there. But yeah, that believe that just everything that you love about wrestling in that moment was watching a grown man shouting, "I believe I can fly!"
I
crash on the floor.
I know I can fly at this point. I don't just believe it. I know it. It's a fact. And she's seen it. If you watch the video, just cut it off before the end. You'll see. I can fly.
Just check. I think we've got a couple of clips of it in our montage for the Granite City Showdown event. So go watch that episode if you want. That's a good way to plug it into there. It was good to see you back at WrestleZone. It's been a long time.
Yeah, far too long. I love WrestleZone. WrestleZone is one of the places where I really found myself as a wrestler. I feel like they gave me a chance to kind of be in those big spots, be in those big matches at a time where I wasn't getting that elsewhere. So it's always a pleasure to go up to WrestleZone, and there's always. You see, now as a promoter, WrestleZone's exciting in a whole other way, because it's like, I'm going to go up here and the chances are they're going to have some guy who's amazing and I've never seen him before. You know what I mean? Like, is it like it's all the way it always kind of has been. Not so much recently, guys been expanding a wee bit more, but they kind of tend to keep to themselves in WrestleZone a lot. They kind of stay within their own scene. And every time you go up, they've always just got these brilliant wrestlers, especially now with the school as well. They've got a great school, a lot of guys coming through there. I've seen a couple of them come down to the dojo as well, and in general, WrestleZone is fantastic. Like, if you're a Glasgow wrestling fan or Edinburgh and you're listening to this, the same way that a lot of their fans will come down here and check out your shows, I absolutely would recommend going up there, having a night out in Aberdeen and checking out some WrestleZone.
When I was sitting with a couple of your lads there, and when Rhys Dawkins came out, there was a lot of like going, oh man, this guy's amazing. This guy's amazing. Yeah. And I was like, yes, everyone should know about Rhys Dawkins. He's a Shakespearean actor turned wrestler. Everyone needs Rhys Dawkins on their show. So it's good to kind of hear. It's nice to see guys come up and speak so positively, because like, I'm in the bubble. So people, the biased bubble is of the Northeast. So it's nice to have folk come up and kind of, again, Captain Holt, the vindication. When they go, yeah. Oh, this is good. I'm like, oh, thank God. I'm not making it up.
it's absolutely brilliant. Like, they're putting on some of the best shows in the country.
So elsewhere, we have one more question, but I think it's kind of a biggie. Elsewhere, you've had your trip to Mexico. You went into a bin. I think it was that Border Pro, or was that Bleeding Gums you were thrown into?
Bleeding Gums, I went into a bin.
And you fought near a statue at Border Pro. Is there anything that you haven't really... you want to tick off, you need to tick off at this point? I noticed you ticked off Lexi Lux's wish of having a death match with you recently. Yeah. You faced Alice Inc. and our past guest of the podcast. You've wrestled in China, you've wrestled in Mexico, you've wrestled worldwide. What's left?
I'd say for me now, the big dream as a wrestler is America. In any kind of capacity, it doesn't. I'm not saying that like I want to go and get a big contract and get signed for that. That would be nice. But in terms of, I like to wrestle in places that I also want to go to. If that makes sense, like places that I want to travel and see. And I've always loved America. There's always this kind of, you know, big holiday blues when I'm leaving America, because I absolutely love it there. So yeah, like to have a serious run in America. I've wrestled there before. I've had matches in America in the past, but a continuous run with a promotion. The W3L, for example. Something like that, but in America. Somewhere that I'm there all the time. I've got consistent stories. Something that I can really sink my teeth into. Something that people can get involved with and follow along with, you know, be entertained by. America, Japan would be another one. Obviously being to Asia and did China, but Japan is just is such a bigger scene than the rest of Asia, than the rest of the world. I always say to my trainees, there's three major markets in wrestling. And it's Mexico, America and Japan. In my kind of opinion, obviously had a good run there in Mexico, which was cool, and I'd like to do that again. But I'd like to finally get into Japan as well. And get that third market ticked off.
Especially for America, it'd be quite cool to I know KJ Mack is wrestling out of Battle Club Pro, and he spent his time at Iron Girders, so it'd be quite cool if there was a kind of a little bit of a Scottish hookup on your way through as well, and they've got the Scott Reekins with him and Dave Rivera, so there's plenty. There could be a little bit of a thing there that could possibly happen, but you never know.
Yeah, and speaking of the kind of New York scene where KJ is based, for any Buffa fans, he's going to be starting his own organization out there, internationally known wrestling. And they're going to be doing some shows in New York, so just be sure to stay tuned to social media and stuff. And you never know what Scottish stars might pop up over there as well. Obviously, Buffa's a big part of VALOR, is going to be a big part of the Scottish scene going forward. So I'm sure he's going to be bringing over a lot of talent for that.
Fantastic. So we've been talking for ages now. We'll wrap up with this one last question, and then we'll kind of go on our merry way and see what is on the horizon for VALOR and what have you. We'll end with the rad lad, Gaz Williams. He's asked, top five deathmatch wrestlers you want to wrestle with or against, I suppose.
So Sabu is number one.
Always
Sabu. Again, can we put Mick Foley in there? We'll leave Mick Foley out since he's inactive. But
he was teasing it, wasn't he? He wanted to do one last deathmatch.
He was teasing that comeback. But I'll leave Mick Foley aside while he's inactive. Hopefully he does come back. But Sabu tops the list. I'd love to work with Mance Warner, who's done some deathmatch stuff in America. Drew Parker is a big one that I'd love to work with. He's recently kind of came back to deathmatch wrestling. Emerson Jane is somebody that I want to work with. She's made it known that she wants to work with myself as well. So promoters listening, and what I see, two people kill each other. That's an option that both sides are going to be keen on. I'd like to go to town with Iceman again. Obviously we did a big death match at W3L. Me and Jack could do something good. I'll put Lou Nixon in there, and that we've worked together in the death match. And kind of won a wee bit, maybe a wee bit kind of left field, but people don't always think of BT Gunn when they're saying deathmatch wrestling, but BT Gunn was a king of insanity, and you know, has had his fair share of death matches. He's somebody that I've wrestled a lot. We've worked together in Girders a lot. I'd put him on that list as well. So that's probably a bit more than five, but yeah.
wee bit, but it's fine. Who's counting? I wasn't. So I'm just going to double check my notes just to make sure we definitely haven't missed anything super important. I mean, being part of Sweden's first deathmatch show in 10 years as part of Valor, being on their show with that on there, that's pretty historic. And is that just kind of Valor's MO now, where it's just kind of creating history wherever they go?
Yeah, like, Sweden's a very, very rowdy crowd, and although kids are welcome there, it's just always been a more adult thing in Scandinavia in general, I would say. So yeah, they were always reacting very well to, much like you were saying, oh, that's going to be a big brawl. They love a big brawl in Malmo. So they reacted well to that, and I thought, well, if they like this, let's take it up a notch and see how they take that. And sure enough, they loved that. So we gave them another one the next month with Lexi Lux as well.
Yeah, fantastic. So before I wrap up, just because it popped into mind, I know you're a big collector of all things gaming related. Have you got the Game Boy Advance cartridge with the Deathmatch on it? It's through Deathmatch Outlaws. Assuming that has to be part of your collection.
So I was going to pick one up and I didn't at the time, but Andrew from Bleeding Gums has picked one up for me. So although I don't have it yet, I will have one eventually. But yeah, right, as soon as I seen it, I was like, yeah, I got to get one of those.
I know, I'm sitting here thinking I need to order one, and I keep thinking I need to at some point, because I've got a Game Boy Advance sitting on my bedside cabinet with currently Pokemon Crystal in it. I need that. Would that be kind of a niche bucket list thing for you to have a match of yours on a Game Boy Advance cartridge?
Maybe not even necessarily just one of my matches, but just even to like put some Valor stuff on there, and do something like that. I'd love to bring out a Valor show on VHS. Everyone's always kind of on at me saying, when are we going to see the shows back? When are we going to get to see them? So you will, but they're all coming out on VHS.
That's amazing. I've got a VHS player in my loft. Fantastic. Well, I'm all in.
No problem. See, that's what I'm doing. I'm marketing it to all the sound folk, all the people who get it.
Oh, yeah. When I've seen say with the merch table, and when you put up stuff that you've picked up on in your journey, I'm like, that's so cool. I have no space for that, but that is so cool to have. Anyway, we could probably have an hour discussion on weird stuff in that, and merch and all that kind of thing, but we'll leave it for now. This has been a fantastic catch-up. I'm glad that we've got this sorted. We should possibly maybe try to do this every couple months and talk about Valor stuff in general.
Yes,
but in the meantime, for people that want to find out more about Looking Sharp, Valor, and everything else you want to plug, where can they go?
So at Wrestling Valor on Facebook and Instagram. Probably getting that wrong because it was also confusing because there's been so many other Valor wrestlers before us. We had to swap so many different things about. But we are on Facebook, we are on Instagram, and we are on Twitter. Search Valor Wrestling and you'll find us on there. And we do have a YouTube channel. You can go back and see Chris Renfrew's return to wrestling after 6 long years. You can watch that back and relive it. And then hopefully we will have all the events coming to streaming services and YouTube as well.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me again.
No, thank you very much for having me.